today is the anniversary of the bombing of the beautiful German city of Dresden, which was bombed on St. Valentine's Day in February 1945.
Burned alive.
Dresden was bombed for 36 hours. Two nights and one day of continuous bombing by thousands of British and American bombers. Total death roll of the town is estimated to lie between 50,000 and 100,000 killed in one 36-hour long orgy of death. We are here today to think of the civilians killed in the bombing war of the Second World War. Hundreds of thousands of civilians were killed, bombed, blasted to death in their homes in an orgy of terror as they lay quivering in their own homes. Victims of deliberate murder of the bombing campaign of the Second World War.
Richard, as a school teacher, can you actually explain why people say that it was not because they were civilians and that was the wickedness? There was a military reason, there was a strategic reason, and therefore they excuse this Holocaust, this sacrificial burnt offering of people, which of course did result in an inter-Gentile war for whose interest neither side benefited except for the State of Israel. Can you actually say what were the arguments and why they are fallacious about the fact that the bombing was somehow justified?
There can have been no justification for that bombing.
London dinner of the Foreign Press Association became an event of worldwide importance, for the guest of honor was the Prime Minister of Great Britain.
A war today
is fundamentally different from all the wars of the past, inasmuch as its first and its most numerous victims would not be the professional fighters, but the civilian population. And when the war was over, whoever was the victim, was the victor, he could leave behind a trail of suffering and loss that two generations would not obliterate.
Cannot too strongly condemn any declaration on the part of anybody, wherever it may be made and on whatever side it may be made, that it should be part of a deliberate policy to try and win a war by demoralising the civilian population through a process of bombing from the air. That is absolutely contrary to international law. The difficulty arises when one of the forces engaged in aerial warfare, being accused of deliberate bombing of civilians, deny that they were bombing civilians, or that it was deliberate, and allege that they were in pursuit of military objectives. I wish to add that whatever the lengths to which others may go, His Majesty's government will never resort to the deliberate attack on women, children, and other civilians for purposes of mere terrorism.
When the tragedy of the Second World War commenced just 20 years after the end of the First World War, both sides agreed in the beginning that there would be no bombing of civilians, no bombing of cities and towns hundreds of miles behind the front. Both sides agreed at the beginning of the Second World War that, as in the First World War, the fighting would be restricted to the front. It was only when Winston Churchill became Britain's Prime Minister in the spring of 1940.
The book's major criticism of Winston Churchill is that he was so obsessed with defeating Hitler, he failed to see the long-term consequences for Britain.
He stood as a person for historical immortality. He got the historical immortality, but at the cost of a war which ruined the British Empire, introduced socialism into Britain.
The book also argues that Neville Chamberlain saw the consequences of war better than Churchill, Chamberlain's successor as Prime Minister, and that Churchill failed to see that the destruction of Germany would create a Soviet threat which would last long after the war was over. The book, Churchill, The End of Glory, has been called probably the most important revisionist text since the war by the historian and former minister, Alan Clark.
But Churchill became obsessed with Hitler. There's no doubt about that. And Churchill saw his life's purpose as being the total defeat of Germany. It's a dangerous condition for a statesman to get into. Too obsessive.
Churchill could and should have made peace with Hitler rather than seeking his unconditional surrender, according to both Clark and Charmley.
It's been almost heresy for nearly 50 years now to criticise Winston Churchill's general conduct of the Second World War. This new book may indicate that a reappraisal is now overdue.
A clamour at the time, in the spring and early summer of 1940, for the war to be ended. A leading Conservative politician within the ranks of the British establishment, I'm referring here to Rab Butler and others, said this war is serving no purpose, it is damaging Britain, it is damaging the future of Britain, and should be terminated with some sort of agreement, some mutual agreement, and the peace feelers being put out by the German government should be responded to.
If Churchill had accepted Hitler's peace offer in the summer of 1940, that would have been the end of Churchill's illustrious career.
Mm-hmm.
He would have been voted out of office, mm-hmm. Lord Halifax or some other worthy would have taken his place, and Churchill would have been written off history the way that he wrote Chamberlain off history. If you remember, Churchill said about Chamberlain when Chamberlain was near death, he said, "Poor old Chamberlain, there he goes. History will be very harsh on him because I know that I'm going to be writing the history." And I think Chamberlain, of course, has had a bum rap from history ever since. I think he's one of the men who tried most valiantly to preserve the peace and the British Empire.
So said voices in the British establishment, including Rab Butler. Unfortunately, the war party with the new Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, intended that the war should commence. And their technique for extend, their technique was to extend the war into so-called strategic bombing of cities hundreds of miles behind the front lines.
The primary purpose of these raids was to goad the Germans into undertaking reprisal raids of a similar character on Britain. Such raids would arouse intense indignation in Britain against Germany and so create a war psychosis without which it would be impossible to carry on a modern war.
Mr. Dennis Richards writes, if the Royal Air Force raided the Ruhr, destroying oil plants with its most accurately placed bombs, and urban property with those that went astray, the outcry for retaliation against Britain might prove too strong for the German generals to resist. The attack on the Ruhr, in other words, was an informal invitation to the Luftwaffe to bomb London.
And so it was that Churchill gave the order for the bombing of German cities hundreds of miles behind the front line. And inevitably, after a few months of having their cities bombed, the Germans retaliated and they started bombing London, Coventry, Birmingham, Liverpool and other British cities.
Hitler only undertook the bombing of British civilian targets reluctantly, 3 months after the RAF had commenced bombing German civilian targets. Hitler would have been willing at any time to stop the slaughter. Hitler was genuinely anxious to reach with Britain an agreement confining the action of aircraft to battle zones.
The tragedy was, of course, that when the British cities were bombed, the British had never been told that this was in retaliation, in legitimate retaliation. That all the British public knew was that their cities were being bombed, and of course a clamour went up for retaliation in the opposite direction. And so the dreadful dynamics of the aerial bombardment of civilians took its dreadful course, and as a result of that, we have in Britain to mourn the death of 50,000 civilians and, of course, the 50,000 aircrew who were killed in that dreadful bombing campaign. And yes, and so, the whole bombing war was totally, totally unnecessary.
As observed by Philip Knightley, a war correspondent for The Times, in his book about Truth, the First Casualty of War, quote, Churchill was obsessed with getting America into the war. He tried to frighten Roosevelt with the prospect of an early German victory. He searched for an outrage, such as the sinking of the Lusitania in the First World War, that would arouse American public opinion. German bombing of British citizens might well achieve this. But for weeks it looked as if the Germans had no intention of being so obliging. End quote. Because we were doubtful about the psychological effect of propaganda's distortion of the truth, that it was we who started the strategic civilian bombing offensive, we have shrunk from giving our great decision of May 11th, 1940, the publicity it deserves.
I see you have the book of David Irving here with you, Richard. I believe when he wrote that in 1963, before that, the general public did not understand the issues that you are speaking about.
I think he had regrets about the bombing that he had done, because after the war he tried to make out that he hadn't known it was going on. Victor Gollancz, who was a famous publisher, who was going to publish my Dresden book originally, Victor Gollancz went to see him, and Churchill said to him, the one thing I thought was very, very wrong was the bombing of Dresden and these cities. And Victor Gollancz said, Winston, how can you say that when, of course, as you know, you were the one who gave the orders? And this was Churchill already window dressing and trying to change the course of written history. But thanks to people like me, you can't change the course of written history. I made plain very early on that when you're a historian, if you're not a conformist historian, very early on you find out you've got a choice in life as a historian, and one got the choice of either being rich or writing the truth.
I wonder, can you explain the issue that they now try to use to say it wasn't about the idea of bombing Dresden was for some strategic reason? We've spoken about it earlier. Can you recall what is that argument and why it's fallacious?
David Irving served truth and the honour of Britain, it can be said, wonderfully with this book. Prior to the publication of this book in 1963, some 20 years, 18 years after the dreadful events, David Irving exposed the full horror of Dresden, which until that time had been kept from the British people. They had not understood quite what had happened in Dresden. The death toll may be as much as 100,000.
I spent months reading something like 2 million of these telegrams sent by the SS and the police commanders all over Europe. And that's where you find the truth. For example, you've seen it on my website probably. March the 24th, 1945. Chief of police in Dresden, reporting to Berlin. 5 weeks after the terrible British air raid on Dresden. He reports to Berlin saying, "Today the Lord Mayor of Dresden has informed me that he has opened these missing persons bureaus all over the city, and that as of this morning, 80 to 100,000 people are still registered by name as missing from the air raid." So all the people who tell me that only 5,000 or only 10,000 or only 20,000 people were killed in the air raid on Dresden, they didn't know about the existence of this intercepted message where the Lord Mayor tells the Chief of Police 80 to 100,000 people are still registered by us as missing, and the previous telegram 1 week earlier has made plain that when somebody registered as missing, that means they are just a little heap of ashes, totally incinerated and unidentifiable somewhere in the ruins of the city. The decoded messages are absolutely platinum value.
David Irving exposed the full horror of that, and he exposed the wickedness of so-called strategic bombing, which just extended the horror of the war to killing civilians, a deliberate policy of killing civilians. I might say that the Air Ministry, towards the end of the war, their deputy secretary, Spite by name, said that our bombing of civilians was a glorious thing to do. Well, I don't think many people, when they think and consider the full horror and the inevitable retaliation here in Britain, would agree with that opinion. Not when they consider the full opinion. And Irving did truth, and let it be said, the honour of Britain, a great service when he brought this book out as long ago as 1963.
They, the British air chiefs, argued that the desired result of reducing the German industrial production would be more readily achieved if the homes of the workers in the factories were destroyed, if the workers were kept busy arranging for the burial of their wives and children. Output might reasonably be expected to fall.
It was concentrated on working class houses because, as Professor Lindemann maintained, a higher percentage of bloodshed per ton of explosive drops could be expected from bombing houses built close together rather than by bombing higher class houses surrounded by gardens.
Well, you can justify anything if you want with words, but it just, the strategic bombing, the deliberate targeting of civilians, women, children, old folk, was to make the war, the ghastliness, the horror of the war, a hundred times worse. Of course, those who advocate the bombing of cities are always going to justify it in terms of, oh, there was factories here and there was railway marshalling yards there.
But when you launch, that was what I was thinking about. Yes.
But when you launch 1,000 bombers against a city, you're going to kill. I think the total death toll in Europe. The German death toll, the French death toll, because the RAF and the Americans were bombing French cities. Who knows that? Who knows that the RAF and the Americans were bombing French cities, our allies? If you add that to the Italian civilians and the British civilians and the civilians in Holland, who can justify that? Who can justify that?
Yes, and if they were bombing railway sidings and other arguments, surely it would not be necessary to flatten the entire historical heritage of Germany to do that, plus all of the victims of the firebombing.
We remember all those victims, and in particular, we remember the British victims. 50,000 civilians, men, women, children, mothers, expectant mothers, old folk, 50,000 here in Britain killed in the bombing war in their own homes here in Britain. And we also remember the British airmen who flew in those planes, those very brave young men who flew in those planes, 50,000 British aircrew were killed in the bombing war on European cities.
Tail damage to one of the returning forts heading back to base after the attack on Wilhelmshaven.
Those young men were idealistic and they gave their lives. They were intelligent, they were officers, officer material, young men who gave their lives.
A Thunderbolt makes a crash landing after an encounter. One of the aircraft which helped to screen the bombers from German interceptors.
The average age of those young pilots was 22 years of age.
As attorney Jürgen Rieger noted, quote, our loss today is because kindred Europeans gave their best and bravest.
Here, in the middle of London, in the bustle of the London streets, we are thinking of those hundreds of thousands of civilians killed in their own homes. We can say that during the war itself, there were those who raised their voices in protest and objection to this murderous campaign. In the House of Commons itself, in the House of Commons behind us, MPs, there was Richard Stokes, the MP for Ipswich, who campaigned in the House of Commons against this murderous campaign.
In 1941, on the 24th of July, Stokes put a question to the Prime Minister, answered by Deputy Prime Minister Attlee in Churchill's absence. He asked the Prime Minister whether he would consider making a convention with the German government for the cessation of nighttime bombing and bombing of cities, and whether he will take steps to ascertain the opinion of the people of this country on this proposal. No, sir. May I ask the Right Honourable Gentleman whether he has observed that the policy now being followed has been described by a competent military critic as contagious lunacy? And will he ask his Right Honourable friend on what grounds he makes the statement that if such a convention were offered, it would not be acceptable to the people of this country? I'm not aware of that statement, and I should have thought that everybody realised that no convention made with the present rulers of Germany would be acceptable. This is not the point of my question.
Then he is interrupted and not permitted to finish.
On the 6th of March 1945, Richard Stokes asked, I have always questioned whether bombing could win a war. The Russians seem to take great cities without blasting them to pieces. I leave out the moral issue. I have given up in despair trying to persuade people on that issue. On the strategic issue, what are you going to find with all the cities blasted to blazes and disease rampant? May you not well find that you will simply be overtaken by your own weapons and that the disease, filth and poverty which will arise will be almost impossible either to arrest or to overcome? I wonder very much whether it's realized at this stage. I have read with horror of the raid on Berlin and the bombing of millions of refugees who crowded into it. When I heard the minister speak almost gloatingly of the great crescendo of destruction, I thought, what an expression for a cabinet minister of Great Britain. Austin Hopkinson interjected, I do not know whether the on member is aware that the propositions which have been put forward as to the value of strategic bombing and his own views on the matter have a very large measure of support from leading military and Air Force staff opinions. Stokes replied, I'm glad of that interruption. I had, of course, heard that. The difficulty about quoting people in responsible positions in the service is that the Gestapo,
meaning the British Gestapo,
get going to worm out those who have been talking to you, and not very comfortable results may be inflicted upon them in their career. I've been told over and over again in my travels that just as every military man objects to the term of unconditional surrender, you also find responsible people in the Army and Air Force protesting against this mass and indiscriminate slaughter from the air.
Air crews were receiving final instructions from station commanders.
In the opinion of the weather prophets, this is the night, and the plan is on. Now the target is an old friend to many of you, it's the city of Cologne. The route is almost direct. I'll show it to you. It's almost direct, base, Uchtdorf, direct to Cologne, on your target there, turn southwest, Euskirchen, and then direct to Nordland, and then direct to base. That's all. Good luck to you all.
Outside, the huge bombers were being loaded with the largest cargo of high explosive and incendiary bombs ever to be carried by one striking force to a single objective. As you can see, the WAF were directly concerned in this all-important job. Tons and tons of beautiful bombs were tucked away, ready for the night's operation. At dusk, the colossal force set out. Heavy bombers of many types took off from aerodromes all over the country. Only perfect staff work could have achieved the devastating success of this raid. For something like an hour and a half, bombs were dropping at the rate of about 20 tons a minute. Just work that out.
Typically, this British newsreel carried the lie that Churchill's terror bombing was retaliatory.
The pall of smoke which covered the target area for days afterwards made reconnaissance photographs difficult to get. But from these pictures of previous raid results, it's easy to imagine what Cologne looks like today. We already know what the RAF have done to Rostock, Lübeck and other places. This was before the Thousand Plan came into operation. Home again. The boys certainly seemed satisfied with their night's work, and rightly so.
Well, we certainly give Cologne good pacing this time, anyway. I looked down over the target, nothing but a sea of fire.
Never seen so many aircraft in the air before in my life.
I think the amount of aircraft we sent over and the amount of bombs dropped and everything else really completely foxed the defenses, etc.
Hello, boy. Have a good trip?
Yes, fine. Bang on, Tiff, yes. With it, absolutely.
Well, boy, certainly might have missed the line. What did you think of it, then?
Yeah, we certainly hit him under the chin that time, then.
Hit him under the chin, gave him a kick fair and square in the seat of the paint.
Well, boys, you ain't been to the word cabin strike. Well, I don't suppose I owed you cologne. Well, so good now.
There's only one thing that I'm afraid we shan't be doing this trip again for a very long time. Nice though it was, because there doesn't seem to be very much left to pay attention there.
I now wish to read to the House a dispatch from the Associated Press correspondent from Schaeff on the 17th of February. Allied air chiefs have made the long-awaited decision to adopt deliberate terror bombings of German-populated centres as a ruthless expedient to hasten Hitler's doom. More raids such as those carried out recently by heavy bombers of the Anglo-American Air Force on residential sections of Berlin, Dresden, Chemnitz and Cottbus are in store for the Germans for the avowed purpose of heaping more confusion on Nazi road and rail traffic and to sap German morale. The all-out air war on Germany became obvious with the unprecedented daylight assault on the refugee-crowded capital with civilians fleeing from Russian aid in the east. I did not want to read that to the House without taking some trouble to vary its authenticity. It was published very widely in America, it was put over the Paris radio and released by the censor at 7:30 p.m. on the 17th of February for publication in this country. It was objected to by some people, and at 11:30 on the same night it was suppressed from publication in this country. It was said it was put out so as to get it abroad, but the people here were not to be told. That is the usual way the government treat people in this country. It was widely broadcast in America, broadcast on the Paris radio to Germany, but not communicated to people in this country who are at least supposed to be responsible for what is going on. It is in keeping with the Quebec decision 2 years ago that at least 50 German cities were to be bombed out quite indiscriminately, as quoted in the Daily Telegraph of 19th of August 1943. All I want to say in conclusion is this. Is terror bombing, perhaps the Minister will answer me, now part of our policy? If so, why was this declaration from Schaeff issued for publication and then suppressed? If it is not part of the policy, why was the statement handed out at all? Why is it that the British people are the only people who may not know what is done in their name?
He was seconded in the House of Lords by the Bishop of Chichester, who also campaigned against this murderous campaign, the bombing campaign.
In the House of Lords on the 9th of February 1944, George Bell, Lord Bishop of Chichester, said, quote, "Berlin, the capital of the Reich, is four times the size of Hamburg. The officers of the government, the military, industrial, war-making establishments in Berlin are fair target. Injuries to civilians are inevitable, but up to date, half Berlin has been destroyed, area by area, the residential and the industrial portions alike, through the dropping of thousands of tons of bombs, including fire phosphorus bombs of extraordinary power. Men and women have been lost, overwhelmed in the colossal tornado of smoke, blast and flame. It is said that 74,000 persons have been killed and that 3 million are already homeless. The policy is obliteration, openly acknowledged."
The greatest number of planes ever sent on a daylight mission by the 8th Air Force were flown to Wilhelmshaven. Backed up by other heavyweight attacks elsewhere, which came soon after, Germany received 4,000 tons of bombs in 24 hours. Selected targets methodically rubbed out by terrific concentrations of bombers.
This is not a justification of war. Again, Berlin is one of the great centers of art collections in the world. It has a large collection of Oriental and classical sculpture. It has one of the best picture galleries in Europe, comparable to the National Gallery. It has a gallery of modern art better than the Tate, a museum of ethnology without parallel in this country, one of the biggest and best organized libraries, state and university, containing 2.5 million books in the world. Almost all of these non-industrial, non-military buildings are grouped together near the old palace and in the street of the Linden. The whole of that street, which has been constantly mentioned in the accounts of the raids, has been demolished. It is possible to replace flat houses by mass production. It is not possible so quickly to rebuild libraries, or galleries, or churches, or museums. It is not very easy to rehouse those works of art which have been spared. Those works of art and those libraries will be wanted. I wonder whether your lordships realize the loss involved in that. How is it then that this wholesale destruction has come about? The answer is that it is the method used, the method of area bombing. The point I want to bring home, because I doubt whether it is sufficiently realized, is that it is no longer definite military and industrial objectives which are the aim of the bombers. But the whole town, area by area, is plotted carefully out. This area is singled out and plastered on one night. That area is singled out and plastered on another night. A third, a fourth, a fifth area is similarly singled out and plastered night after night until, to use the language of the chief bomber command with regard to Berlin, the heart of Nazi Germany ceases to beat. How can there be discrimination in such matters when civilians, monuments, military objectives and industrial objectives all together form the target? A few days ago, as reported in the Sunday Express of January the 23rd, an air marshal said, quote, "One by one, we shall pull out every town in Germany like teeth," end quote. I shall offer reasons for questioning this policy as a whole, but what I wish immediately to urge is this. There are old German towns, away from the great centres, which may be subject, which almost certainly will be subjected, to the raids of Bomber Command. Almost certainly they are on the long list. We ought to think once, twice, and three times before destroying the rest.
In addition, there was the British philosopher, C.P. Snow, Charles Percy Snow, who asked these dreadful questions. Snow asked, in the future, will men regard us as monsters for organizing this bombing campaign? Will men regard us as monsters, and will they say that we had abandoned our humanity?
As Snow says, quoted by F.J.P. Veal,
quote, "All arguments concerning the British bombing of Germany during the Second World War were brought abruptly to an end in April 1961 by a single paragraph in a little book with the uninspiring title Science and Government. The author was Sir Charles Snow, scientist and novelist. His purpose in writing it was to assess the respective achievements of two rival physicists, Professor Lindemann and Dr. Henry Tizard. The book was primarily concerned to show that when the opinions of these two men conflicted, Dr. Tizard always proved to be right and Professor Lindemann always wrong. To this he was compelled to disclose the truth concerning one of the principal issues which arose between them. In a nutshell, Sir Charles Snow disclosed that early in 1942, the exact date it now appears was March the 30th, Professor Lindemann submitted a minute to the War Cabinet in which he urged that bombing henceforth should be directed against German working class houses in preference to military objectives which were much more difficult to hit. He claimed that given a total concentration of effort on the production of aircraft suitable for this work, 50% of all the houses in the cities and towns in Germany with over 50,000 inhabitants would be destroyed. Sir Charles declared that the Lindemann plan to initiate terror bombing against Germany was adopted by the British government and put into action with every effort the country could make. This decision of the War Cabinet was kept a closely guarded secret from the British public for nearly 20 years until it was unobtrusively revealed in 1961 in a little book entitled Science and Government. Quote, "Factories and military objectives had long since been forgotten, except in official bulletins. The paper claimed that, given a total concentration of effort on the production and use of aircraft, it would be possible in all the larger German towns, that is, those with more than 50,000 inhabitants, to destroy 50% of all houses." End of quotation from C.P. Snow's book.
In his postscript a year later on the Lindemann controversy, featured in The New Scientist, Snow also quoted Professor P.M.S. Blackett on the direct outcome of the strategic air offensive. 500,000 Germans and 160,000 British and American airmen killed, but little effect on German war production or morale.
C.P. Snow said they would be right to ask these questions because we did abandon our humanity.
On 13th February 1945, I was a navigator on one of the Lancaster bombers which devastated Dresden. I well remember the briefing by our group captain. We were told that the Red Army was thrusting towards Dresden and that the town would be crowded with refugees, and that the centre of the town would be full of women and children. Our aiming point would be the marketplace. I recall that we were somewhat uneasy, but we did as we were told. We accordingly bombed the target, and on our way back our wireless operator picked up a German broadcast accusing the RAF of terror tactics, and those 65,000 civilians had died. We dismissed this as German propaganda. The penny didn't drop until a few weeks later, when my squadron received a visit from the Crown Film Unit, who were making the wartime propaganda films. There was a mock briefing, with one notable difference. The same group captain now said, "As the marketplace would be filled with women and children, on no account would we bomb the centre of the town. Instead, our aiming point would be a vital railway junction to the east." I can categorically confirm that the Dresden raid was a black mark on Britain's war record. The air crews on my squadron were convinced that this wicked act was not instigated by our much-respected governor, Butch Harris, but by Churchill. I've waited 29 years to say this, and it still worries me.
And in the middle of the war, the British pacifist Vera Brittain wrote her book, one voice against the bombing law. And she answered C.P. Snow's questions. She said at the end of her book, at the last sentence of her book, she said, if there are enough people who protest against this evil of the bombing war and who describe the bombing war as barbarism, then there may be a hope and healing and a reconciliation in the future. And we can but say amen to that prayer of hers. Amen, let there be hope and reconciliation in the future. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much. Security, yeah?
But I need to, yeah, just to let you know that if
you've heard of the MP Shirley Williams, who was an MP about 20 years ago, when I was a bit younger than that, she was the mother, very fine woman. In the First World War, she had been a nurse. In the First World War, her brother was killed, her fiancé was killed, two of her best friends were killed. She was a nurse in Flanders, and she came back a pacifist. A bit like that woman over there who's campaigning against the war, yeah?
I'm with the peace strike campaign in Westminster, Parliament Square here behind us. We're right opposite the Houses of Parliament, which is our government in the UK. Beside me now we've got this big display board, end the corporate war in Afghanistan, as we're saying, it's mainly business interests. Honour our troops, we're not against our troops. A lot of them are young boys, they're sent to war on, basically on lies. But they're not going to be told that. They're going to be honourable and to save people. That's what they think. So basically, we want the war ended and we want the troops home safely. We've got a white peace poppy here. The red poppy quite often donates, or a lot of people feel it does, the sort of glorification of war. So here we are. This is like a giant tomb, if you like. But we need our troops home. We need to break the cycle. The point is, there's an awful lot of pressure building up politically within the square in this area at the moment. Yesterday the police had a meeting and apparently they're trying everything to find an excuse to get rid of these boxes and the tents. However, they're confounded because legally they're unable to do it, and they've admitted that. It doesn't mean, however, that they might not do it. There is still a danger they might find some sort of excuse or through some sort of security risk. We don't know. But however, I made the gesture of covering up the boxes because I knew that it would be talked about. And on the radio, he said, well, look, we'll send a lorry down now. We'll pay for it. I've got the big cranes, and they can be taken. These can be put into storage, and we'll pay for it. So, but I said actually that was not possible. We couldn't be compromised on that issue.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have here with us today Dr. James Thring and school teacher Richard Edmonds, and we are here to commemorate the bombing of Dresden and the cities in England during World War II, and the tragedy of the civilians. We have some of our colleagues here and some of our colleagues in Dresden today on the 14th of February.
I think the bombing of Dresden was a war crime because it was targeting civilians. No military advantage to be gained by destroying a city full of civilians and refugees, and therefore it should be taken to court. We've got the Supreme Court of Justice just behind us. We ought to be going there and saying that although it's rather out of time, in order to stop further wars by this government, we've already destroyed Iraq, and there have been 35 other wars started by the Americans since the Second World War. It's time we took these people, even though they don't exist any longer. They should be remembered, not by a memorial, which they're building now, or about to build in Green Park, a huge temple-style memorial for Bomber Command. Though they were defending the country, they should be incriminating these people so that they don't do it again.
A nation which spreads over another a sheet of inevitably deadly gases, or eradicates entire cities from the earth by the explosion of atomic bombs, does not have the right to judge anyone for war crimes. It has already committed the greatest atrocity, equal to no other atrocity. It has killed, amidst unspeakable torments, hundreds of thousands of innocent people.
Bombing civilians is definitely a crime. And the way it was done at the end of the war, when it was completely unnecessary, because there was no chance of Germany winning in 1945, I would say we have a good case in international law. If they don't accept it here, once we've tried, we can go to the International Criminal Court or the International Court of Justice, because that didn't exist in 1945, and ask them to adjudicate on this in the interests of stopping any further annihilation of innocent civilians. And apart from anything else, we should apologize to Germany for the massacre of their people.
Richard H.S. Crossman, Labour government minister at the time, later declared, quote, "The long-suppressed story of the worst massacre in the history of the world, the devastation of Dresden in February 1945, was one of those crimes against humanity whose authors would have been arraigned at Nuremberg if that court had not been perverted." Unquote.
And as Lord Hankey told the House of Lords on the 5th of May 1949, quote, "There was something cynical and revolting in the spectacle of British, French and American judges sitting on the bench with a colleague representing a country which before, during and since the trials had perpetrated half the political crimes in the calendar." End quote.
That's a very important point.
Like there should be an apology to Japan, again in a country that had even withdrawn from war. They said they had declared peace, and the Americans knew it, but the Americans wanted to destroy any chance of a revival of that axis. They terrorized them, in effect, into not doing anything.
Without historical truth, there can be no international justice. And I think you're quite correct, because these are the things that establish what has been misrepresented in our history.
Yes,
and as a school
right.
teacher, I think Richard would probably have more to say on this, because our children in schools are not being taught the sort of understanding of World War II in particular that permits them to realize that it was not a heroic thing that Britain did, but it was a victim of an inter-Gentile war which was not to its benefit at all. So we really need to look to the culprit and to who benefited. As I say, Israel benefited when it was eventually formed in 1948. A sacrificial burnt offering was made of the Dresden bombing, fire warning of people from above, in a covenantal bargain, as it would seem, to gain the state of Israel. But I wonder whether there's some other point that you'd like to make in terms of historical truth.
We're here in London, which is proud to call itself the Mother of Parliaments, proud to call itself the cradle of democracy, proud to call itself somewhere that respects the rule of law. Indeed, here behind us, alongside the Supreme Court, is the central hall where the first ever meeting of the General Assembly of the United Nations took place. And yet, the gross injustice that we commemorate today, being falling under a hail of bombs, a hail of explosives, those civilians who were killed in the most brutal fashion as a result of decisions taken here, as a result of a gross injustice rooted here among these people in the Mother of Parliaments in this supposed land of justice. Those dead civilians remind us of the hypocrisy that for so long has lain at the heart of that Mother of Parliaments, the hypocrisy that now lies at the heart of the United Nations as well. Because sad to say, we here in England, which was supposedly fighting against occupation, were already
and are already today an occupied land. Occupied by rulers, by puppet masters behind our rulers, who do not have the interests of our people at heart and do not have the interests of the civilians of the world at heart.
One wonders how fictional were the words of Britain's 19th century Prime Minister, Benjamin Disraeli, when he wrote, quote, "If the history of England is ever written by one who has the knowledge and the courage, the world would be astonished. All great events have been distorted, most of the important causes concealed. Some of the principal characters never appear, and all who figure are so misunderstood and misrepresented that the result is a clear mystification." End quote.
So when we remember the gross injustices perpetrated today by the United Nations, we can set this in the context of the injustices perpetrated 67 years ago today by people making decisions here in London who were prepared to allow to condemn defenceless civilians to death in a tragic European Brothers' War. Let's hope the people of Europe awake and say to each other, never again. We Europeans will have a Europe to be proud of, a Europe ruled by Europeans, in the interests of Europeans, where the interests of those civilians are respected. Let us look forward to that day when Europe stands up and rules itself again.
F.J.P. Veal, in his book Advance to Barbarism, said, quote, "The inhabitants of Coventry, for example, continue to imagine that their sufferings were due to the innate villainy of Adolf Hitler, without any suspicion that a decision, splendid or otherwise, of the British War Cabinet was the decisive factor in the case." End of quotation.
Intentions
are different. That's the key word, yes. If you intend to massacre people, it's genocide. And if you kill them by accident, it could be a war crime, but it also can be excused as collateral damage.
FJP Veal's book, Advance to Barbarism, in quoting the so-called Lindemann Plan, drawn up inside the British government in the middle of the war, would substantiate that thesis. And of course, a major factor to bear in mind here is that in the earlier stages of the war was still there to be won or lost. Mm-hmm. Most of these so-called terror bombings are taking place in the latter stages of the war, when Germany is virtually defenceless in terms of its air defences. And this, of course, is the very reason why such enormous night after night raids with huge numbers of bombers are even possible, let alone whether they were strategically desirable or not.
Yeah.
They become possible because your enemy is defenceless. So you're hitting him with the most enormous force precisely at the point when he is A, most defenceless, and B, least justifiably being attacked, because he's not in a position to win the war by that stage.
So at that point it is actually gratuitous and very different, actually, from other bombings.
I think the Lindemann plan is somewhat backed up by the book by Charles Perry called The Fifth Man, which gives away the secret effect of Lord Rothschild and the Jewish cabal behind Churchill during the war and also afterwards, in which they had a mission obviously connected with the setting up of the State of Israel to damage German interests as much as they could in order to stop the Germans stopping them going to Israel, because the Germans weren't in favor of the idea because they saw it as a Palestinian land, not as an empty place with nobody in it. And Churchill was constantly being battered by Rothschild and Sir Zolly Zuckerman into doing things which probably he wouldn't have wanted to do, given his conscience. And that would explain why he said to Bomber Harris, carry on with this campaign, where Bomber Harris himself was rather reluctant to carry on with it. So I think one ought to read that book by Charles Perry. It's based on information discovered by a KGB officer who had access to the files when the Soviet Union collapsed. And he gave this information to Charles Perry, and it has all the records of the Rothschilds feeding the Russians with information about our nuclear development, about our war strategy, about what Churchill really thought, and so on. So it's quite a crucial piece of information, and it's been suppressed. You can't get the book easily anymore.
Churchill's policy of terror bombing was part of a war strategy that was designed to serve interests other than Britain's. Alongside Professor Lindemann, other influential figures in Churchill's scientific and intelligence operations included Lord Victor Rothschild, about whom Philip Knightley asked the key question: which country did Rothschild spy for? Europe's suicidal brothers' war served the interests of Rothschild's true masters, the World Zionist Movement, whose creation of the State of Israel in 1948 was the outcome of maneuvers which had destroyed British imperial power and created a new bipolar war of nuclear-armed superpowers. The Zionists had for years before 1948 assisted the Soviet cause, with Rothschild and his friends leaking secret intelligence to Moscow, only to reinvent themselves as loyal supporters of America once the Cold War began in the late 1940s. Herzl's founding Zionist policy of, quote, creating jealousies among the nations, unquote, and, quote, playing off the empires against each other, thus continued decades after his death. Based on his interviews with the British KGB spy Kim Philby, Philip Knightley puts the case that, quote, Rothschild had given an allegiance to Israel and had helped Mossad in the early years, end quote.
And apart from the fact that it's a very good thing for our people to understand that there were people in Britain at the time and now who stand up and say, what we have been taught in our schools is simply not accurate. Its source criticism is not really active in our schools.
And therefore, it's going to lead people to say, well, it's okay to bomb other countries and other cities. We'll get away with it.
So there must be some means for the public to understand that it has been some kind of swindle.
Yeah. Therefore, we should have taken next step, which is to say, well, now let's have the other side into court after Nuremberg and get things evened out. This is what justice is supposed to be about, isn't it?
And source criticism is bringing up more documents, more evidence that change our historical understanding. And I think, Richard, you might like to elaborate perhaps on the Nuremberg trials, because we were told by, at the time, 1945-46, by five Supreme Court judges in the USA that this was a judicial farce. It is actually the basis of the UN, United Nations, and yet it was a judicial farce.
Well, it's certainly true that without truth there can be no justice. The Nuremberg trials, organised by the victors at the end of the Second World War against the defeated German leaders, is another aspect of the horror and tragedy of the Second World War. We're standing in front of the courts of law, which are now labelled the Supreme Court in Britain, a new term for us, a new term brought in by the late Labour government. As for the Nuremberg trials organised by the victors at the end of the Second World War against the defeated German leaders, the Nuremberg trials, as organised by the United States of America, the Soviet Union, Great Britain and France, those trials claim to lay the basis of justice for the future world, and yet those trials were condemned at the time by leading American contemporaries. The number one judge in the United States of America, Harlan F. Stone, described the Nuremberg trial as a lynch mob. He was totally condemnatory in the terms that the number one judge, Harlan F. Stone, the Chief Justice of the US Supreme Court, condemned America's participation in that tribunal, as did a leading American politician, US Senator Robert Taft, said that America's participation was a blot on the honor of the United States of America, and that in the future, Europeans would condemn the United States for partaking in those Nuremberg trials. And they were seconded by further American judges. William Douglas condemned the trials. Judge Wennerstrom condemned the trials. And Judge Edward Van Roden said of the trials, how did it come about that Germans confessed to various wicked crimes? Edward Van Roden said, I can tell you how those German prisoners of the American army, were induced to make those confessions. Edward Van Roden examined 137 German POWs captive by the American army, and those 137 German captives had been tortured to such an extent that their testicles had been beaten beyond all repair. The American judge, Edward Van Roden, went back to the United States of America. He held a press conference in New York City, and he described the horrific findings that he'd found. And he said, that's what caused those Germans to make those self-condemnatory confessions. And yet to this day, the Nuremberg trial is held up as the pinnacle of justice. It is the basis of the United Nations, and it is the basis for the justification of the whole of the post-world ordering of the world, including the justification for the Second World War, which is a war that should never, ever have been fought.
Silence for the victims, the civilian victims.